Is that a medley?
No, that's a spot, man.
Well, there was one theme line that I wanted to sing. Good morning.
Good morning.
It is good to be gathered together. We thank God for the rain. Farmers are delighted, I pray. I know it's not enough, but...
They're happy.
Okay, good. That was tough. It was really interesting how the picture worked out that born anew to serve comes out from the quilt. That must be a mission statement. This picture of the kits, there's on the left side a couple of personal care kits, on the right side baby care, and some of the things are really hard to get. So let me know. What we did receive a grant from Thrivent, an action team, so we have money to spend on purchasing things or ordering, so we'll have to do that this week or next week, so that we can complete our kits. Or maybe we'll complete them after the fact, I don't know. I'm grateful for people signing up to be part of that event on the 12th. And we have a couple of grills lined up, so we have a great lunch after our service activity on September 12th, so we're looking forward to that. There's no end to troubles. You ever feel like that? Things to be concerned about. Pastor Grace Johnson has been a cloud over the community, but also to see the community come together around the family and in their sadness. Not being carrying that weight, but finding a way to lift it up, like the balloons that rose to heaven in the football game. And I thought it was strictly inspiring that when the first touchdown was scored, poof, blue confetti, blue being Grace's favorite color, marking that score. I didn't get the memo about blue shirts, but also need to see all that support and for sure stay for that. 13 of our finest killed along with more than 150 Afghanis. There's wildfires, there's Hurricane Ida, things to make us afraid. And if you listen to the way the news is reported sometimes, that seems to be the trajectory. Well, we aren't defined by those things. We're defined by our response to those things. And there are people finding hope in Afghanistan. There are Christian organizations that are doing what government is not doing to help people get out, to know that they are valued, cherished, and God is making a way. The point of this slide is that no matter how heavy things can be, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. So I invite you to stand up. Wave to one another. Everybody rose up in the balcony there. Steve over here at the console. It's good. There is a card for these, well, you can make stand. I'll try to be brief. A card for Evan Holmes around somewhere. Maybe it's out on the table in the fellowship hall. Evan was injured last year playing football. He was injured last Friday night in the game again. I haven't talked to his family. I don't know. Got the report. I was glad to see that mom was right there in the care. So we lift him up in our prayers too. Flowers on the piano are the Gowing family in honor of
Sally.
Okay, that's what was on my tongue, Sally. And the flowers on the altar continue to Greg, honor of Carla Cole's birthday, but their anniversary together also. So we celebrate these gifts that we can share together. Next, and the pie sale coming up. There's a table that you almost trip over as you come in. The pie sale sign up there. It is an activity of the congregation, and the money raised for the pie sale is going to light shades up here, but also the Lanzi art camp for next year. Wabash. Next Sunday, St. John's Lutheran in Essex is having a fellowship meal. So if you want to just go from here and go up there for lunch and not worry about doing lunch or doing dishes, you can do that next Sunday. And next Sunday also we'll have to work for you. So look forward to celebrating that. Part of knowing that we are complicit with some of those troubles in the world, we begin our worship with a three-word confession and hearing God's words of forgiveness. Lord, we come to you this day, having seen your miracles of recreation in the world. We have enjoyed both the bright sunshine and the gentle rains. We have marveled at the beauty of flowers and the complexity of your creation. Make our hearts ready to receive your word for us, that we may go forth from this place, ready to joyfully serve you all our days. Amen. Dear Lord, forgive us when we have seen your miracles all around us and yet still doubt your power, your presence, and your love.
Forgive us when we treat this world and each other with careless indifference or despise their differences. You who have created the most wondrous things from the smallest of particles, and create in our hearts confidence and hope. Give us the ability to give the Holy Spirit the love of your love. In our lives, you can fashion the most delightful miracles which deserve you through acts of mercy and kindness. Free us, Lord, to receive your blessings, and having received them, to find the numerous ways in which we have served you. Please hear our cries. Heal our wounded hearts. Come to us and bring us home. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
God is never farther from you than your own heart. In the mercy of Almighty God, you are forgiven of your sins. Because God wants more for us than to be crushed under the weight of sin. Jesus went to the cross for the forgiveness of your sins. And together with the Father and the Holy Spirit pours God's love and mercy on you, in you, and it flows through you out into the world.
Thanks be to God.
Gathering Him is to know we are Christians by our love.
Thank you.
Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We unite our voices in prayer. O
God, our strength, without you we are weak and wayward creatures. Your commands ensure justice and give structure to our lives. Protect us from all dangers which attack us from the outside, and cleanse us from all evil that arises from within, that we may live the abundant lives you desire for us. Amen.
Please be seated. Today's lessons are kind of a refresher on your confirmation class on the Ten Commandments.
Today's first reading speaks of the seal God put on the promise of the Holy Land. It is their forever inheritance through faithfulness to the commandments which provide just boundaries for our relationship with God and fellow humanity. Now the reading from the fourth chapter of Deuteronomy, beginning with verse 1. And now, Israel, listen carefully to these laws and regulations that I am about to teach you. Obey them so that you may live, so you may enter and occupy the land the Lord, the God of our ancestors, is giving you. Do not add to or subtract from these commands I'm giving you from the Lord your God. Just obey them. If you obey them carefully, you will display your wisdom and intelligence to the surrounding nations. When they hear about these laws, they will exclaim, "What other nation is as wise and prudent as this? For what great nation has a God as near to them as the Lord our God is near to us whenever we call on him? And what great nation has laws and regulations as fair and just body of laws that I'm giving you today? But watch out. Be very careful never to forget what you have seen the Lord do for you. Do not let these things escape from your mind as long as you live. And be sure to pass them on to your children and grandchildren. The word of God, words of life."
Thanks be to God.
Now let's read responsibly part of Psalm 15, a psalm of David. Who may worship in your sanctuary, Lord?
Who may enter your presence on your holy hill?
Those who lead blameless lives and do what is right,
speaking the truth from sincere hearts.
Those who refuse to slander others,
or harm their neighbors, or see the evil of their friends.
Those who despise persistent sinners,
and honor the faithful followers of the Lord, and can keep their promises even when it hurts.
Those who do not charge interest on the money they lend, and they refuse to accept bribes to testify against the innocent.
Such people will stand firm forever.
Today's second reading answers the question, what good is there for anyone who turns and follows Jesus? Our lives lived obedient to God's commandments reveal the power of God's justice to produce good in human hearts. Now the reading from the first chapter of James, beginning with verse 17. Whatever is good and perfect comes to us from God above, who created all heaven's lights. Unlike them, he never changes or casts shifting shadows. In his goodness, he chose to make us his own children by giving us his true word, and we, out of all creation, became his choice possession. My dear brothers and sisters, be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. Your anger can never make things right in God's sight. So get rid of all the filth and evil in your lives and humbly accept the message God has planted in our hearts, for it is strong enough to save our souls. And remember, it is a message to obey, not just to listen to. If you don't obey, you're only fooling yourself. For if you just listen and don't obey, it is like looking at your face in a mirror and doing nothing to improve your appearance. You see yourself, walk away, and forget what you look like. But if you keep looking steadily into God's perfect law, the law that sets you free, and if you do what it says and don't forget what you heard from God, He will bless you for doing it. If you claim to be religious but don't control your tongue, you're not just fooling yourself, and your religion is worthless. Pure and lasting religion in the sight of God our Father means that we must care for orphans and widows in their troubles and refuse to let the world corrupt us. The Word of God, words of life.
Thanks be to God.
Children, come forward. Children's message. School started, right? Excited? Okay. To be excited and excited. You don't have to be just one. Well, do you know what your job is at school? Where you go? To listen. And what happens when you listen, when you learn? You have another job. To be a Christian. What do you think that means? It looks like. You're lent paper or pencil to someone who didn't have some. Because you're so abundantly blessed that you have extra to share. Right? And even though we don't understand somebody else's sadness, we can still meet them in their sadness. And but not necessarily meet them there, but remind you do have good things going on in the world. You can help bring light. Bring light and hope to situations. So I was thinking about confirmation sermon notes, and that when you think about your sermon notes for the worship service, that light and hope, if you just write down what are the things that experience from the service that are light and hope, you'll have gotten service, gotten worship. But your job, in your job, at work, shopping, all that we do, is to bring light and hope of Christ into those places where we go. So you guys don't just have that job and go to school to be Christian, but everybody has that job. Let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, we give you thanks that we are so richly blessed that we can help others. We can share smiles and hope also. So Lord, be with me. Be my strength that I need. So I can be your servant. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Lord. I want you to stand for the gospel acclamation. Jesus was to confront Jesus. They noticed some of Jesus' disciples failed to follow the usual Jewish ritual of hand washing before eating. Commentary added on here, the Jews, especially the Pharisees, do not eat unless they poured water over their cupped hands, as required by the ancient traditions. Similarly, they eat nothing brought home from the market unless they have immersed their hands in water. This is one of but many traditions they have clung to, such as the ceremonial washing of cups, pitchers, and kettles. So the Pharisees and the teachers of religious law asked Jesus, "Why don't your disciples follow our age-old customs? For they eat without first performing the hand-washing ceremony." Jesus replied, "You hypocrites, Isaiah was prophesying about you when he said, 'These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far away. Their worship is a farce, for they replace God's commands with their own man-made teachings.' For you reject God's specific laws and substitute your own traditions. For instance, Moses gave you this law from God: honor your father and mother. If anyone who speaks evil of your father and mother must be put to death. But you say, 'It's all right for people to say to their parents, sorry, I can't help you, for I have vowed to give to God what I could have given to you.' You let them disregard their needy parents. As such, you break the law of God in order to protect your own tradition. And this is only one example. There are many others too. Then Jesus called the crowd to come and hear. 'All of you listen,' he said, 'and try to understand. You're not defiled by what you eat. You are defiled by what you say and do.' Then Jesus went into the house to get away from the crowds, and his disciples asked him what he meant by the statement that he had made. 'Do you not understand either?' Jesus asked. 'Can't you see that what you eat won't defile you? Food doesn't come into contact with your heart. It only passes through the stomach and then goes out again.' By saying this, Jesus showed that every kind of food is acceptable." And then he replied, "It is the thought life that defiles you. For from within, out of a person's heart, come evil thoughts: sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, wickedness, deceit, eagerness for lustful pleasure, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these things come from within. They are what defile you and make you unacceptable to God." The Gospel of the Lord. There seem to be various interpretations, even conflict among God's people on the basis of the interpretation of what it means to be faithful to God's commands. Why did God give us these commands? Let's not forget that it's so that we might have abundant lives that God wants for us together in community. Today's psalm sets a really high standard. "Who may worship in your sanctuary, O Lord? Who may enter your presence on your holy hill?" And the psalmist answers with positive examples. Those who speak the truth with sincere hearts, refuse to slander others or harm their neighbor or speak evil of their friends. Those who honor the faithful followers of the Lord and keep their promises even when it hurts. Thanks be to God for the forgiveness of sins and Jesus' death on the cross and resurrection to new life. Our sins are forgiven. And we know we need this because we're aware how easy it is for us to slip into sin, particularly those ones that Jesus is referring to that originate in our own hearts. I'm drawn to the identity that is offered to Israel in our first reading today. An identity that would be theirs if they will live within the boundaries of God's commandments. What other nation is as wise and prudent as this would be said of them? For what great nation has a God so near to them as our Lord God is when we call on Him? And what great nation has laws and regulations as fair as this body of laws I'm giving you today, God declared through Jeremiah? Joshua. Yet internalizing that identity could lead to the sins of pride and arrogance if they thought more highly of themselves, as if this power and wisdom was theirs rather than God-given. Is there an antidote? Humility is the antidote. Humility is the antidote that Jesus, God, demonstrated in humbling His own Son. And even in the disciples that Jesus chose, there's humility. Humility and gratitude. So I, with caution, will say that I am grateful to belong to and be counted among the people of this nation where we have a framework of laws based upon the Ten Commandments. Honor God's will expressed in the Ten Commandments. Even though Commandments 1 through 3 aren't specifically addressed, that being to have no other God above our God and not to use God's name for our own benefit, only to honor God. These are not included, but they're implicit in that we recognize that the rights and the responsibilities that we have come from God, originate with God. And they aren't just about ourselves, but they're about our lives together with neighbors and co-workers and family and strangers. It is God who empowers us to be humbly compliant with the laws that He has given us, calls us to obey. Today's first reading from Deuteronomy likewise assumes the implicit power of God's authority over our lives. God's authority over our lives. This reading marks a moment when the people of Israel were poised to go into the promised land, and yet, like our society today, it's so easy to forget that what we have and given comes from God. So He's warning them to keep these commandments, which are safe boundaries for them. It's a moment not unlike a moment captured in first day of school pictures. We're sending our children off to school into a new opportunity. We trust a future for them, that they will receive in school education that is beneficial. What is it that awaits our children and the teachers? Isn't it true that each year adds learning, greater understanding, brings personal growth, both through good and difficult experiences? We want our sports teams to win, right? Yet not without a challenge. If they only played less skilled teams, would they be inspired to continue to develop their own skills? We are from and we live among a people who seek the best for our children, our neighbors, or co-workers. We want high and healthy standards of health for ourselves and for others? We expect for those who have not learned these high standards that our example will inspire them to also seek those better ways, those better behaviors and attitudes, to see the benefits and believe that a good life is possible for them also. Believing in this, we contribute to efforts and agencies which exist for the purpose of providing the necessities for life, secure and meaningful life. I believe we can claim, without being too prideful, that if we carefully observe the boundaries that God has established for us, for His people, that we will display wisdom and intelligence to the peoples around us, and it will be a blessing from God's people to all the world. That's why it's baffling that people who consider themselves to be examples for others to emulate, that is, the Pharisees, came to where Jesus wants to cancel him. They seized on his disciples not washing his hands to try and cancel Jesus' authority. And we should note, in Jesus' response, he's not denying the validity of the laws that Moses gave or the individual commandments. What Jesus is doing is rejecting an interpretation which creates division, criticism amongst God's people rather than unity. That's why Jesus came, to build unity amongst God's people. We know hypocrisy when we see it. Avoidance of God's purpose, substituting something else. It's an aspect of human rebellion which God addressed centuries earlier through the prophet Isaiah. Jesus applied the words in today's reading. Those people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far away. Their worship is a farce, for they replace God's commandments with their own man-made teachings. For you ignore God's specific laws and you substitute your own traditions. I think Jesus expects them to see how those traditions serve them but not others. And that God's will is that we serve not only ourselves, but we build community with one another and with strangers. We know that hand washing is important. We teach our children. We encourage all others to wash their hands. The season of COVID has had us doing all sorts of things and being very cautious about sanitation and that. We want other people to do that because it's good for them. Not out of fear, but because it's good for them and for others. But that's not what this complaint is about. When the Ten Commandments were first presented by God to his people, he asked them to be a priestly people, a holy people, a holy people in the midst of others who were not. In her commentary on today's gospel, Elizabeth Johnson says, the Pharisees took this calling to be a priestly kingdom and a holy nation very seriously. They interpreted the laws concerning the priests who served in the temple to apply to all God's people, to all aspects of life. Well, as priests serving in the temple were required to wash their hands before entering the inner sanctuary, before offering sacrifices, the Pharisees believed that all God's people should wash their hands before meals as a way of making mealtime holy, a that's not a bad thing. That we should thank God for the food we're about to receive, that it is actually a holy thing, that we recognize God has provided. But they're talking about the hand washing accomplishing that. They wanted to bring every aspect of life under the canopy of God's law. Well, I personally, struggling with my own sin, I prayed to God to bring all of my life out into God's view, asking that God would show me how I can best live these passions in my heart. What is God's will for them? Because I know they can be used for evil and harm, harming myself as well as others. So I'm going to pray to ask God to show me what it is He intends and what it is He desires. The problem with the Pharisees and the scribes, according to Jesus, Elizabeth Johnson continues, was that they become so focused on those external acts of faithfulness, they had neglected to look at their own hearts, to examine their own hearts. I believe Jesus, who can see into our hearts, understood that their attempt to discredit His mission was about envy, jealousy, coming from their hearts. And as long as they equated eating with unwashed hands with ritual defiance, Jesus is going to make this a teaching moment and talk about what really defiles. It's an immoral thought life. Jesus speaks about the thought life that comes from our hearts. These evil thoughts do great harm to those harboring them, and upon those the evil thoughts become focused or are acted out. Theft, murder, adultery, greed, deceit, lust, envy, slander, pride, recklessness. The Ten Commandments are a gift to us because they set boundaries around these very things. Not for ourselves alone, to convict us in our sin. That's the first use of the law, is to make us aware of our sin and our need for God's mercy. The second use of the law is to form and give structure to our life together, to society. And these are boundaries for us to observe with one another. But if I'm coveting somebody else's property, that's not, I'm approaching a boundary that I should not cross. That the law makes clear. We even have responsibility through the commandments to help one another live full and meaningful lives. Well, by the grace poured out on the cross in Jesus' death, and the power of the Father's love to raise Him to new life again, we know that God chooses not to condemn us in our sin, but rather to restore us to life through forgiveness, through grace. Jesus became, in His person, the remedy for human sin. That's the center of the good news. That God has done this for us through His Son. He's given us salvation from sin, a way of reconciliation, and leads to eternal life. You are precious to God. You always have been precious to God. You, your children, your family, our neighbors, even when we disagree with them, God's loving each and every one of us. Even the Pharisees and the scribes, Jesus did not leave in their folly, but rather sought to illuminate for them the truth of our Father's gracious love, good purpose in giving the law. The Lord our God did not send his Son to condemn humankind, but rather humbled himself so that through him, his generosity, we should be reconciled to God and one another. Captive to such grace, rather than captive to fear, but captive to such love and grace. James writes these words. Understand this, my dear brothers and sisters. You must all be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to get angry. Human anger does not produce the justice God desires. So get rid of all the filth and evil in your lives and humbly accept the word God has planted in your heart, where it has the power to save your souls. Thank you, Almighty God, that we are drawn to, that we have grown up in families that brought us to church, that we have learned how great your love is for us. And Lord, help us to accept that job that you give us to be your witness, your hands and your feet in the world, to show that love, to demonstrate it with our lives, even when it hurts. For we know, Lord, that nothing will separate us from the comfort and the peace and love that we have with you. Amen. Let you stand as we sing our hymn of the day, Just As I Am. Together our faith with the whole church, words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
God has been so generous to us, how can we keep from not wanting to bring back to God and for his purposes a portion of what he has first given us? So, worshiping at home, there's the address there. We invite you to send your offering in. Still with COVID restrictions, we're not passing the plates, but we do celebrate the opportunity to bring our offerings. As we sing today a new offertory, familiar to some of you, but I think very significant words for us to sing together as a church.
Presence and blessing. Work through pastors, musicians, teachers, greeters, readers, and worshipers that we may echo your expansive and generous welcome. Lord, in your mercy.
Please hear our prayer.
We pray for the whole of creation, that plants and animals have habitat and resources to thrive and flourish. Inspire in us gratitude and desire to protect threatened habitats and ensure a sustainable future for generations to come. Lord, in your mercy.
Please hear our prayer.
We thank you, Lord, for the freedom and responsibilities entrusted to us. We pray for those in positions of authority and decision-making. Give them wisdom and discernment for the scope of their responsibility, international, national, state, and local. Lord, in your mercy.
We lift up our prayer.
Make room in our hearts, O God, for all who are in need. Send support and encouragement to those suffering addiction, poverty, and underemployment. Help us see that all have adequate shelter, clothing, and stability for life, as you have provided care for our homebound friends and loved ones, Jackie, Waddy, Mabel, and residents of care centers, Ron, Byron, Eldora. Lord, in your mercy.
Please hear our prayer.
For your presence in this congregation, we praise you, especially with those beginning a new school year. Andy and Allie, Lily and Gavin, Mary and Megan, Claire, Logan and Paige, Will and Maddie, Evan, Tyler, Superintendent Carey, Crystal, Teresa, Lisa, and all students, teachers, and support staff. Accompany also and inspire the support of parents, foster parents, and caregivers. Lord, in your mercy.
Please hear our prayers.
Holy God, we especially lift up family and friends of Grace Johnson. Comfort them in their mourning. We give you thanks for those who have shown us how to trust in your mercy and honor you with our hearts, who now rest in your eternal care. By their example, inspire our faith that trusting in you, we will be united with them in glory. Lord, in your mercy.
Please hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Continue our worship singing, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Oh,
May you be blessed by our worship time together. And as we conclude that time, receive this blessing. Blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who provides for us, nourishes our souls, and journeys with us, give you peace now and always.
Amen.
Graciously. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.